welcome to City Point Church online live stream. We're so glad that you could join us today. We are moving through our series on The Chosen. We're in season two and it is getting better and better. But before we get into that, we're going to worship. So turn up your volume and let's sing.
Your window, so don't let it pass you by. Lift your hands to the heavens. Lift your voice to the sky. Praise the Lord of all creation. Let his name be lifted high. Stand before you now, as honestly as I know how. Broken by the days gone by, Spirit, help my soul to rise. But still I fail, and even then you're with me. You remind me I'm a child of God, regardless of the things I've done. Oh, my hope is found in perfect love. triumphs over judgment. Love wider than the horizon, stronger than all sin. Lord, your kindness leads us to repentance, to the heart of God. You are, O God, is all I want.
Amen, amen. The only thing better than worshiping with you guys right now is worshiping in person. And if you're watching this live on the 7th, this evening at 6 o'clock at the Apollo, we're having pop-up church. You're invited. We want you there. You don't want to miss it. If you haven't yet, don't forget to follow us on Facebook and join our family and friends Facebook group. That's where we put all the information about meeting more regularly. We've got great news when it comes to the building. We've closed and the city planning committee has approved our usage of the building as a church. It's moving on to the next step. We're so excited. Continue to cover this up in prayer as God leads us and directs us. If you'd like to give to City Point, there are two really easy ways. You can give online, citypointchurch.tv/give. You can also give by mail at the address below. And as you're taking care of all that, I want to know, what celebrity do people say you look like? Drop down in the chat and let us know. Let's get into it.
I'm preparing something to share with the world. These things will make sense to some, but not to others. I'm here to start a revolution.
Oh Lord, give me a sign, 'cause I'm tasting blood and I think that it's mine.
His care is for women, for the vulnerable.
Blasphemy is not harmless.
Well, the Pharisees were pretty upset.
Sometimes you gotta stir up the water.
They're martyrs with a persecution complex.
Take me down to the water.
I wanna kill him.
Just take me down to the water.
Do you want to be healed?
I have something that's open to all people. Get up and walk.
If he was supposed to be healed, God would have done it himself.
That's an interesting point. Your fame is spreading, the good kind.
You have certainly livened things up around here.
Word travels fast.
Fellow peasant.
My heart is yours. My life is yours.
John the Baptizer was taken into custody.
Jesus of Nazareth, we finally meet.
David, Goliath, maybe there is hope for the little.
What we're doing here will last for generations.
I want my people to participate in the healing of the world.
I do not feel very much worthy.
Who's worthy of anything?
You?
The one comfort we have is to know that we're doing it together.
It's not now.
When?
I'm here to preach the good news of the kingdom of heaven. I make a way for people to access that kingdom. In this world, bones will still break. Hearts will still break. But in the end,
yeah!
The light will overcome darkness.
Hey, glad you made it. I know at times that we question what the all-powerful God is doing or allowing. But if you were writing the story, What would you do or allow to convey your love better than what he has done? Now, I realize at times we would like to change some of the details of the narrative along the way, but doesn't our inability to see everything past, present, and future bring a big hamper on insight? I mean, think about it. If eternity has been placed in my heart, if eternity has been placed within my thoughts, my dreams, I think about it. I wonder what's going to happen after this life. If eternity is there and I choose to disregard those thoughts and focus only on this temporary physical existence, won't that limit my vision? Truthfully, we understand very little of this all-knowing, ever-present, supreme being. But because he is all-powerful, we can understand that he needs nothing, right? I mean, all-powerful and self-sufficient, those are mutually compatible, aren't they? You can't really have one without the other. Because he is all-powerful, he has no unmet need. So if this God, who doesn't need anything, says something like this, look at this passage. He chose us to adoption by Jesus Christ to himself according to the good pleasure of his will. Does that truth speak of need? Why, no. It's very clear. He adopted us because it was his pleasure. Unfortunately, we do live in a world filled with unwanted pregnancies, but there's no such thing as an unwanted adoption. To adopt a child is to choose a child, to desire a child. You weren't adopted by God because he needed you. You were adopted by God because he wanted you. It wasn't an accident. It was a plan. Think about this truth in light of this all-knowing God. Neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future nor any powers, neither height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God. Now, is that unconditional love generated from a need? No, that kind of love freely given to us, that comes from desire, not need. What about this truth? This is good and pleases God our Savior, who wants all people to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. God doesn't need us to be saved, but he most assuredly wants us to be saved. It's his pleasure. There may be no better description of God's love for us than replacing his name when the word love is used in the great love chapter of the Bible, 1 Corinthians 13. Look, Jesus is patient. Jesus is kind. He does not envy. He does not boast. He is not proud. He does not dishonor others. He is not self-seeking. He is not easily angered. He keeps no record of wrongs. Jesus does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. He always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Jesus never fails. The love that Jesus has for us is not born out of need. It comes from desire. One more stunning truth. Look at this one. The Lord your God is with you. He will take great delight in you. In his love, he will rejoice over you with singing. Now that's some imagery right there, isn't it? Taking delight and singing over someone with joy doesn't speak of need. It speaks of love. It speaks of desire. Would growing in our knowledge and experience of God's love and desire for us have a changing effect? Definitely. Do you know that your very existence makes God smile? Do you know that your past and present choices have never influenced how God regards you? Do you know God's love for you has never wavered? Never. John Piper has written something that we all should read. Look at this. We must banish from our minds forever any thought that God admits us begrudgingly into his kingdom, as though Christ found a loophole in the law, did some fancy plea bargaining, and squeaked us by the judge. No way. God himself, the judge, put Christ forward as our substitutionary sacrifice. And when we trust him, God welcomes us with bells on. He puts a ring on our finger, kills the fattened calf, throws a party, shouts a shout that shakes the ends of creation, and leads in the festal dance. Y'all, what he is describing there is what Jesus described when he was trying to get us to see what God is like. The issue is not whether or not the Almighty God desires us. The issue is whether or not we believe it. I mean, seriously, what more could he have done? Jesus destroyed the separation caused by sin. Anything we experience on earth won't last. And Jesus is preparing a place for us that will last. What more could he have done? I'm not trying to dismiss or belittle difficulties that any of us may go through. But isn't that the point? Those difficulties are something we are going through. We're not stopping in and being stuck. We're going through them. They won't last. They're temporary. And what is coming? What is coming is an existence with a being too marvelous for description. What is coming is someone whose goodness is beyond understanding. What is coming is a person who, against all odds and without any needs, wants and desires us more than anything else in all of the universe. He has everything he needs, but he wants you.
Torn asunder, and my world just falls apart. Lord, you put me back together and lift me up to where you are. There is hope beyond the suffering, joy beyond the tears, peace in every tragedy, love that conquers fear. I have found redemption in the blood of Christ. My body might be dying, but I'll always be. Have turned mourning to dancing. You have covered me with grace. The struggle here may last a moment, but life with you will last always. There is hope beyond the suffering. Right.
is over, when this world has been reborn, we'll be there beside our Savior. This is our great and rich reward. There is hope beyond the suffering.
Season 2, Episode 5. I'm telling you, you're going to love it. You're going to love it. We are not called to understand how or why a holy God loves and desires an unholy people. That's not our calling, to understand why. Our calling is simply to believe in it. To believe in it, to bask in it, to live in it. Have a great week.
Now Use me how you want to.